Good morning. Today I'll be speaking about the cancers of the testes. The overview of this particular topic is that cancers of the testes are relatively rare cancers and they account only for approximately 1% of the cancers in the male. However, it is very important to know about the cancers of the testes because it is a highly curable neoplasm and the incidence is usually seen in young patients at the peak of their productivity. Anatomy of the testes. The testes is the male gonad. It is equivalent to the ovary in the females. It lies obliquely within the scrotum, suspended by the spermatic cord. The left testes is slightly lower in position when compared to the right testes. The shape is oval. It is about 3.75 centimeters long, 2.5 centimeters broad, and 1.58 centimeters thick. It weighs about 10 to 15 grams. That is, each testes weighs about 10 to 15 grams. And each testes has two poles, two surfaces, and two borders. Moving on to the coverings of the testes, from outside to inside are the skin, the Dartos muscle, the external spermatic fascia, the chromastic muscle, the internal spermatic fascia, the tunica vaginalis, and the tunica albuginea. Moving on to the blood supply of the testes, the arterial supply is derived from the abdominal aorta. The testes has multiple collateral blood supply from the chromastic artery and the artery to the ductus deferens. The venous drainage of the testes is from the back of the testes and it receives multiple tributaries from the epididymis. All these veins unite to form a convoluted plexus called the papilloniform plexus of veins. The plexus forms a single vein which opens on the right side into the inferior vena cava directly and on the right side into the left renal vein. The lymphatic drainage. Each testis drains into the retroperitoneal lymph glands between the levels of T11 and L4, but they are concentrated at the level of L1 to L3 vertebra. The lymph nodes located lateral or anterior to the inferior vena cava are called the paracaval or precaval nodes respectively. The interiotocaval nodes are located between the inferior vena cava and the aorta. The nodes that are anterior or lateral to the aorta are pre-aortic or para-aortic nodes respectively. On the right, the testes drains into the interiotocaval region, followed by the paracaval, and then into the pre-aortic and para-aortic lymph nodes. On the left, that is the left testes, drains directly into the pre-aortic and the para-aortic nodes, and therefore then into the interiotocaval lymph nodes. The metastatic nodal disease to the common iliac, external iliac, or inguinal lymph nodes is usually secondary to a large volume of the disease with retrograde spread. If the patient has undergone a herniorrhaphy, vasectomy, or other transcrotal procedures, then the metastasis can also occur to the pelvic and inguinal lymph nodes. Through the thoracic duct lymph nodes in the posterior mediastinum and supraclavicular fossa and occasionally to the axillary group of lymph nodes. Contralateral spread is mainly seen with right-sided tumors. In 15 to 20% of the testicular tumors, bilateral lymph nodes are involved. Let's move on to the introduction of the testicular tumors. They comprise a morphologically and clinically diverse group of tumors. It predominantly affects young males and accounts for about 1 to 2% of all cancers in the US. Testicular cancer forms about 1% of malignancies in males in India. The incidence is about 0.6% per 1 lakh population, and the mortality is about 0.3 per 1 lakh population. 95% of the testicular tumors are germ cell tumors. 90% of the germ cell tumors are in the testes. 2 to 10% might be extragonadal, mainly in the retroperitoneum and the mediastinum. The cure rate increased with the introduction of platinum-based chemotherapy from 10 to 80%. Moving on to the epidemiology of testicular cancer. Age. The median age of occurrence of germ cell tumors is around 34 years, with 50% of incidence occurring between 20 and 34 years. 50 years or old solid testicular mass is usually due to lymphoma. There are three peaks wherein the testicular tumors can occur. In children between the age of 2 to 4 years, 20 to 40 years, and in elderly age group of greater than 50 years. The highest incidence is seen in Denmark, Norway, and Switzerland, and the lowest in Eastern Europe and Asia. It is more commonly seen in white men than in African Americans. The various predisposing factors of testicular tumors are cryptorchidism, Klinefelter syndrome, positive family history, positive personal history, and intratubular germ cell tumors. Minor predisposing factors include trauma, viral infections, hormonal factors, and exposure to environmental estrogen. Moving on to the pathological classification of testicular tumors. Intratubular germ cell tumors, accounting for about 95% of all the tumors of the testis, of which seminoma accounts for about 40%, and non-seminomatous germ cell tumors account for about 60%. Classification of 6 Cotes stromal tumors of the testis, which account for about 2-3% of the testicular tumors, and others. Seminoma might be mainly of classic type, anaplastic type, or spermatocytic type. Non-seminomatous germ cell tumors might be of embryonal carcinoma type, teratoma type, yolk cell tumors, choriocarcinoma, mixed germ cell tumors. 6 Cotes tumors might be Leydig cell tumors, Sertoli cell tumors, granular cell tumors, fibroma, trichoma, stromal cell tumors, gonadoblastoma, 6 Cotes stromal tumors of unclassified type. And others include lymphoma, rhabdomyosarcoma, and melanoma. Moving on to the commonest variety of testicular tumors, that is a seminoma, and the commonest variety of germ cell tumors, accounting for about 40-50% of all germ cell tumors. Adults are the usual target, usually seen between the age group of 4th and 5th decade, and is never seen in infants. It more commonly affects the right testis than the left testis. It usually starts in the mediastinum and then compresses the surrounding structures. Patients usually present with a painless testicular mass. 30% have metastasis at presentation, but only 3% have symptoms related to metastasis. Moving on to seminoma. In seminoma, the serum alpha-fetoprotein is normal. Beta-HCG is elevated only in about 30% of the patients suffering from seminoma of the testis. Classification is mainly classified into classical, anaplastic, and spermatocytic type. Spread. Direct spread. Basically, direct spread meaning into the structures that are in contact with the testis. It usually occurs by invasion. The whole of the testis is involved and is restricted only to the testis due to the presence of the tunica vaginalis and the tunica albuginea. The tunica albuginea is rarely penetrated, and this is why you should never perform a biopsy in a patient with a testicular tumor, which might lead to seedling along the track of the biopsy and might lead to scrotal involvement, fungation on the anterior aspect, and it spreads to the spermatic cord and epididymis. And the spread to the epididymis and the spermatic cord shows a poor prognosis. Lymphatic spread. Seminoma metastasizes exclusively through the lymphatics. They drain primarily to the para-aortic group of lymph nodes, and from the para-aortic group of lymph nodes, they drain into the retroperitoneal lymph nodes, which again drain into the cisternic hyoid, then to the thoracic duct. From the thoracic duct, it drains into the posterior mediastinum, and then to the left supraclavicular lymph nodes. From the medial side of the testis, the lymphatics run along the artery to the vas deferens to drain to the nodes at the bifurcation of the common iliac group of lymph nodes. No inguinal lymph nodes are involved unless and until scrotal skin involvement is seen or any other testicular procedures or any herniography or a vasectomy is being performed. Hematogenous spread is usually seen in non-seminomatous germ cell tumors, and it usually spreads through the blood route and usually spreads to the lungs, liver, bones, and brain. The clinical features of testicular tumors may be classified into that of the primary tumor, wherein the patient presents with a painless testicular lump, and the patient also has a sensation of heaviness when the size of the testis increases to more than 3 times the normal. Rarely there is a dragon pain complained by the patient and usually seen only in 1/3 of the patient. Usually the testicular tumors might mimic epididymo orchitis. There is sudden pain enlargement due to hemorrhage mimicking a torsion. And the patients also might present you with history of minor trauma, which is usually only coincidental. Clinical features due to metastasis. When there is metastasis, only about 30% of the cases present with metastasis, and about 3% of these cases have clinical features and might have other symptoms due to the metastasis, which include abdominal or a lumbar lump and pain, dyspnea, hemoptysis, and chest pain when there are lung metastasis, jaundice when there is liver metastasis, hydronephrosis due to the pressure effect of the large para-aortic lymph nodes or pressing on the bilateral ureters, pedial edema due to the obstruction of the IVC due to pressure effect by the large mass compressing the IVC. The patients might also present with Trozier sign. On clinical examination, there is an enlarged testis, except for in choriocarcinoma, wherein the testis is normal in size. The testis is nodular to palpate. It is firm to hard in consistency. The patients usually have a loss of testicular sensation, and patient might have a secondary hydroseed, and it is flat and difficult to feel the epididymis. And also, it should also include the general examination for metastasis, that is abdominal examination, examination of the axillary lymph nodes, and also examination of the left supraclavicular lymph nodes. Tumor markers. There are two main classes, oncofetal substances, that is the alpha fetoprotein and beta HCG. Alpha fetoprotein is produced by trophoblastic cells and beta HCG is produced by the syncytial trophoblastic cells. Staging for worker. Basically, you'll have to take the general history of the patient, documentation of any cryptorchidism and previous inguinal or scrotal surgery, and physical examination. Laboratory studies include CBC, LFT, RFT, and lactate dehydrogenase. Serum assays include alpha fetoprotein and beta human chorionic gonadotropin. Diagnostic radiology. Chest X-ray films, posterior, anterior, and lateral views to rule out any mediastinal or lung metastasis. A computerized tomography, that is CT scan of the abdominal and pelvis, to look for any para-aortic, pre-aortic, inter-aortic cable lymph nodes. CT scan of the chest in case of non-seminomatous and stage 2 seminomas to rule out any lung metastasis and mediastinal tumors. Ultrasound of the contralateral testis to rule out any bilateral carcinomas. This is the TNM classification of testicular tumors. And this is the serum tumor markers also play a vital role in the TNM classification of the tumors. Moving on to surgery. Patients usually are offered radical orchidectomy, and it is done via an inguinal incision with cross-clamping of the spermatic cord vasculature and delivering the testis into the surgical field, that is into the inguinal region. And then later, a radical orchidectomy has to be performed. Scrotal violation, that is increased locoregional, will result in increased locoregional recurrence, but there is no difference in distant recurrence rate or overall survival rate. A retroperitoneal lymph node dissection is also performed. The indications for retroperitoneal lymph node dissection include low-stage non-seminomatous germ cell tumors, which include the removal of the pre-caval, retrocaval, paracaval, inter-aortocaval, retro-aortic, pre-aortic, para-aortic, and common iliac lymph nodes bilaterally. The disadvantages of a retroperitoneal lymph node dissection include sympathetic nerve fibers disruption, resulting in a loss of seminal emission. A modified radical retroperitoneal lymph node dissection has been developed, which preserves ejaculation in up to 90% of the patients. The staging of the seminoma, stage 1, wherein surveillance is preferred, or rarely you can subject the patient for an adjuvant carboplatin therapy, or rarely you can give the patient an external beam radiotherapy. Stage 2 A and B are subjected for external beam radiotherapy. Stage 2, C and 3 receive systemic chemotherapy, which is platinum-based chemotherapeutic agents, which increases the survival rate of the patient to about 90%. Non-seminomatous germ cell tumors. Stage 1 tumors can be put under surveillance, or you can provide the patient with adjuvant chemotherapy in high-risk groups, or you can perform a retroperitoneal lymph node dissection. In stage 2, A and 2, B, the patient is subjected for a retroperitoneal lymph node dissection or systemic chemotherapy. If the node is negative, then you'll have to just observe the patient. If nodes are positive, and if there are more than 6 positive nodes, and if any one of the nodes is greater than 2 centimeters in size, then you have to subject the patient for an adjuvant chemotherapy. If less than 6 nodes are positive, and if all are less than 2 centimeters in size, then you'll have to just observe the patient. Or in a patient with stage 2A or 2B, you can subject the patient for a systemic chemotherapy. In stage 2C or 3, the patient is subjected for a definitive systemic chemotherapy and follow protocol for stage 1 seminomatous diseases. The first 1 to 3 years, you'll have to perform a clinical examination and a CT of the abdomen and pelvis every 6 months, and then a clinical examination with a chest radiograph every 12 months. And after 4 to 5 years, you perform a CT of the abdomen and pelvis, a clinical examination. And after 7 years, every 12 months, every year, you'll have to perform a clinical examination, CT of the abdomen. And after 9 years, every year, you'll have to perform a clinical examination, subject the patient for a chest radiograph, and also perform a CT of the abdomen. The principles of radiotherapy for patients being subjected for radiotherapy. This is how to plan a radiotherapy in a patient with a testicular seminoma. Seminoma being the most commonest type of germ cell tumor disease and accounting for about 40 to 60% of the testicular tumors. The indications for radiotherapy or adjuvant therapy for stage 1 to 2B diseases. It is a salvage therapy for locoregional failure after surgery or chemotherapy, and it is a palliative treatment for locoregional or distant metastatic sites. The various techniques of radiotherapy that can be employed in the treatment of a patient with seminomatous disease are external beam radiotherapy to the lymph nodes and high energy radiation of 6 to 18 megawatts. The complications of radiotherapy include acute nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, late small bowel obstruction, chronic diarrhea and peptic ulcer disease due to radiation enteritis, irradiation gastritis, and secondary cancers can also develop in such patients, which accounts for about 5 to 10% of the diseases. With testicular shielding, most patients will have oligospermia by 4 months that lasts for approximately 1 year. Infertility is seen in about 50% of the patients who have a subfertile count on presentation or after surgery. And after radiotherapy, 30% will be able to have children. Moving on to chemotherapy, it is an alternative or adjuvant to radiotherapy for stages 1 to 2 seminoma and adjuvant therapy for stages 2 to 4 seminoma. The various regimens include a single agent, one cycle of carboplatin, becoming an alternative for stage 1 seminoma. Other regimens include BEP of 3 cycles, EP of 4 cycles, PVB and VIP for stages 2 to 4 diseases. The most, this is Lance Armstrong and Yuvraj Singh, both had seminoma. The only difference being between both is Yuvraj Singh had a seminoma in the mediastinum, whereas Lance Armstrong had a testicular seminoma, and both are hale and healthy after being operated.